thank you all for coming. It's my pleasure to introduce my friend and colleague, Dr. Carrie Vroegindewey, today. Dr. Vroegindewey has a DVM from the University of Missouri. He's a diplomat of the American College of Veterinary Preventive Medicine and has a master's in strategic studies from U.S. Army War College. He was an owner of multiple practices for several decades and then joined the U.S. Army, where he became one of the top vets in the U.S. military. He had 750 veterinarians, many of whom he recruited, and was in charge of global food safety for our troops around the world. He tried retiring several times, but he still finds something interesting to do. He became faculty. He was director of global health at the University of Virginia, Maryland College of Veterinary Medicine. And more recently, he's become director of One Health at Lincoln Memorial University in Tennessee. And he's going to talk to us today about opportunities and advances in One Health.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Teresa. And thanks for the opportunity. And thanks for coming in your lunchtime to hear this. It's very exciting to come from the newest veterinary college in North America to one of the oldest veterinary colleges in North America. And so I'm here to talk a little bit, some perspectives, and also listen and learn. What I'd like to do, particularly since we don't have the giant full room, is move through a presentation pretty quickly and then open it up and let's have a little discussion. So what I'm going to talk about is evolving One Health frameworks in the future for global vet opportunities. How many are vet students in here? Okay, so we have a few vet students. Okay, what are you going to do when you grow up? You don't know. That's good. I like it when people don't know what they're going to do, because then everything on the menu is there, as opposed to, you know, I'm gonna work in an all-cat practice in downtown Toronto and only work on Persian cats. I mean, so, because probably if you do that, it won't be what you do your whole career. In fact, if you look at all the faculty and ask them where they started, invariably faculty say, I never thought I would be in academia, or I never thought I'd be here today. So it's good. I'm glad you don't have the plan. I want to come back, and when I talk to my students at the very beginning, I want to talk to them about what it means to be a veterinarian and part of the profession. I'm going to focus on you guys because you're on students. But so from the Canadian Veterinary Medical Association, this is the veterinary oath. It's part of it. And it talks about using the scientific knowledge and skills for the benefit of blank. So what's the blank? Why is veterinarians, what is the blank in here that we're using our skills for? Don't be embarrassed. I was in practice for years, and I took the oath, and I'd even been on a committee that helped write AVMA's oath, which the very first part starts, and I couldn't have told you the answer. So why? What are we here for? And when I ask my students, invariably they'll say, for the benefit of animals, we're here. Well, what we're here as professions are for the benefit of society. We're here for the benefit of society. We're granted very special privileges that no other group can do. No other group can do, because we're licensed to do certain things for animals to benefit society. And so as you take a look at what you do day in and day out, look at it from the point of society. We talked about One Health. This is the second part of the Canadian Veterinary Oath, is to promote animal health and welfare. So that's kind of One Health. Relieve animal suffering, that is, protect the health of the public and the environment. You know? So here's all the pieces of One Health that are identified: animal health, human health, the environment, and then this is not in the U.S. side, advanced comparative medical knowledge, which is One Health. So in the oath, in the very core of what we are as a profession, One Health is embedded in there. And it's what we do across the spectrum for society. We're doing it for society. Doesn't mean we don't care about animals or not doing this, but it's for society. It's important to remember. And then the other thing I try to get my students to understand is veterinarians do One Health, they do public health every day. Got missing. Every day, every encounter you have has a public health aspect to it. So when you're protecting animal health with rabies or through vaccination, you never want this. You never want a ocular larval migrans from worms causing blindness in a child because you did not deworm their animals properly. You're practicing public health every day. So let's look at One Health definition. This is the one I use. American, who use the AVMA's One Health definition. I looked for one on the Canadian vet site and I didn't see a definition there. So we'll use this one that just talks about collaborative efforts, multiple disciplines, working locally, nationally, globally, to optimal health for people, animals, and environment. Pretty straightforward, pretty simple. Now, when the Stone Mountain Group got together, a large consortium looking at One Health and moving forward, they surveyed One Health definitions, and I think they came up with 29 of them. So a lot of, when we talk about One Health, the One Health that we see is lined up with how people perceive it. It's like the fable or parable of blind men feeling the elephant. You know, depending on what part of the elephant you feel, that's how you define it. So one that would feel the side, say, well, an elephant's like a wall. Someone might hold on the trunk and say, well, the elephant is like a large tube, or hold onto a leg and the elephant's like a column, or hold the tail and say the elephant's like a rope. And every one of them would be correct from that vantage point through those lenses, but they still don't have the picture of the entire elephant. Well, that's a lot of what we see when people talk about One Health. Often they're talking about One Health through a certain lens, comparative medicine lens, translational medicine, the human-animal bond lens, the environmental piece. They're looking at it through different lenses. So we'll talk, try to come back from that and keep One Health a little broader. So, well, what's all this One Health thing? Hey, they've talked about One Health in class. Are you like up to hearing it? It's like, oh, you know, Dr. V, if you say One Health one more time, I'm gonna die. But this will affect you. So April 2015, Public Health Agency of Canada said that veterinary drugs, well, they'll have veterinary oversight of all antimicrobials in food animals by the end of 2016. This is going to have big impacts on us. Part of the concern about antimicrobial resistance. So this is One Health in practice, not just a big kumbaya hug. One Health and, you know, like motherhood and apple pie and all good things, it affects you. And the Canadian Veterinary Medical Association has put out an app that you can use as a practitioner. This is primarily focused on companion animals, on using antibiotics appropriately in urinary tract infections. So here's a piece of One Health, and it's not out there for somebody else. It's going to impact what you do every day as you practice. So we'll get a little bit of history here. My students will tease me, oh, hey, Dr. V, did you know Hippocrates personally? No, I did not. But we see aspects of One Health going back a long ways. He had a text on airs, water, and place, and it promoted the concept that public health, being healthy, required a clean environment. So those were two of the elements. You know, people and environment is part of One Health. And then we have Lucius here that had a book on quarantine and segregation, and he said people and animals should be kept on separate farms. And so now you have another link between domestic animals and people. So another part of the One Health ring. We go forward to Rudolf Virchow, and he said between animal and human medicine, there's no dividing line, nor should there be. And the difference is just the experience and basis for all medicine. So this is looking at sort of comparative and translational medicine, things that they observed in animals that could be taken for people and vice versa. So we have another couple of rings that are involved in the One Health arena. Now, this one's kind of interesting to me because a lot of people look at comparative medicine as being a new thing. But if we go back to the Columbia Veterinary College, you can see the dates that it existed, not very long. But the dean at that time talked about a person not being a horse doctor, a cow doctor, but to make them a doctor of comparative medicine. And of course, it's pretty obvious, he also talked about it being a man, right? So not only do we see history in comparative medicine, but look at the name of the college, the Columbia Veterinary College and School of Comparative Medicine. So comparative medicine, translational medicine, is not new. It's been looked at for a long time. But particularly on the human side, as specialization occurred, and even on the veterinary side, that people moved into their own specialty areas and moved away from this common look. So we'll fast forward to Calvin Schwabe and his seminal book on veterinary medicine and human health. And he really then looked at the interface between human health and animal health, zoonotic disease, emerging disease, and environment, and really kind of completes those three rings. So we move forward, and down here in the reference, this is from the World Bank in 2010. So now the World Bank is writing a monograph about people, pathogens, and the planet, One Health Approach to Controlling Zoonotic Disease. This is coming from an economic entity. So this is a big change from looking at it scientifically or medically into economically. And within this document, they use this diagram, which was one of the first of the three intersecting circles of the Venn diagram. And it came from Peter Daszak, who is currently the president of EcoHealth Alliance. And if you take a look at this, we'll take a look at it a little bigger. As we take a look at that, in One Health, it only identified this very narrow spectrum that of wildlife, not environment, but wildlife, domestic animals, and people. And so our first looks at One Health as a profession were really fairly narrowly focused. You see that here. So how well does that work? Well, the experience in Ebola said that really didn't work very well. Our failure in Ebola wasn't that we didn't know enough about the virus or how it might have jumped from, spilled over from animals to people, possibly from eating bats into people, however that occurred. But the problem with dealing with One Health wasn't just that narrow interface, it's a bigger interface, and that is we didn't know about culture. So for example, kissing corpses in Ebola countries. You know, when the Guinea's Ministry of Health indicated 60% could have been linked to traditional burial practices. Well, what good is it to know about how Ebola jumps from animals to people and gets transmitted if you don't know how to control it? And so we have to take a look at these bigger pictures here. So what was our collective Western Ebola response? Well, we sent people in personal protective equipment, PPE, and they were dressed like this, okay? And because they had to protect themselves. And so for our cultural perspective, looking at this, this looked like a lot of protection. It's white, it's clean. What did the people on the ground see? They saw death. They saw death. Because in these countries, white means death. And so when we were sending in people to support it, we were sending people. Actually, there were many, many aid workers who were killed by villagers because they were afraid that they were coming in and disrupting their village. Lots of people were killed. And so from the World Health Organization, we looked at this as a health issue. We didn't understand the cultural aspects. A good friend of Teresa and I, the Gavin McGregor Skinner, here he is on C-SPAN, an infectious disease expert. What they don't say is a DVM. Almost every time I see a DVM on national or international TV, they call themselves a public health expert. They don't identify themselves as a DVM. Shame on you, Gavin. he and I can talk about that. And so this is what we sent in, and this is what the people saw. So we have to expand. If we're going to be effective, if we have to expand, we have to expand One Health. Now, as this starting off with those three intersecting circles, there are many images and many depictions of One Health. This one comes from Sweden, and you look, they're gonna put a big umbrella and we'll make sure we cover everything. So we put a big umbrella over One Health, but if you take a look at it, the big umbrella basically is comparative translational medicine and zoonotic disease. That's it. It doesn't cover all the pieces and parts. It's nice, it works, you know, for them, but it doesn't really cover everything. I just got back from Switzerland last month. I was at the Global Risk Forum for One Health, speaking in Davos, and that at this time, this is what they use for their depiction of One Health. And it included some other areas. We have environment, human health, animal health, and then they had food safety and security and some other pieces of that. And so they expanded the view a little bit of One Health, but not really to the point that it fit. In fact, that came up within the conference. So if we go, whatever happened there. Okay, so if we go forward, let's go back to this original picture. So here's the three intersecting circles. Remember, the dark in the middle was the only thing that was identified with One Health. Everything that we do occurs in another context. That they talk about the ecosphere, ecosystem, but everything that we do occurs in context. It may be political, cultural, social, economic, that they're religious. There are multiple contexts that we take a look at this. And if we're really going to understand One Health, that we have to put it within the sociosphere. I don't even know if that's a word, I just made it up to describe what the context is in the sociosphere. If we have to look at One Health, using that Ebola virus example, we have to look at the very broad picture of how this is impacted in a cultural, political, social, economic context. So I gave this as part of a talk in Switzerland, and then I had found before I went there what I'd seen as the best depiction of what One Health is today. The one I put up here is the one I taught last year to my students. I was kind of proud of it until I saw the one that came from Canada, the public health agents of Canada. And now this, really, for me, this is One Health. Kudos to Canada for coming up, because it talked about human, animal, health, ecosystem, but around the outside is global context, economics, and culture. So really understanding that all of these things, you can know all the science, but if you can't make it work in a cultural, economic, or social context, it's not going to be complete. So this for me right now is the best graphic that defines what One Health is. In Switzerland, I got pinged, and it's not my graphic, but where it says ecosystem, what I got pinged in is the environmental people said it should say environment, not ecosystem, because ecosystems include the animal and human component to it. So the ecosystem is actually bigger. So the environmental people get pretty edgy about this, because what they say is, we don't have One Health, we only have two-thirds health. You're focusing on animals and people and you're forgetting the environment. And so the two-thirds health comes up a lot. So as a depiction of this, I go back all the way to Edward Hicks and his Peaceable Kingdom. We can look at the interface between people and domestic animals. And we can look at the interface between people and wildlife. And we can look at the interface between wildlife and domestic animals. And that was that smaller gray area in One Health. But it doesn't give us the whole picture. If we're going to look at the whole picture, we have to look at the environment and how these all three interact there. But that's not enough. And as curious as we go back in this painting, back into the early 1800s, that we also see that these things occur within a political and a social and a cultural aspect as we see Native Americans trading. And so to really get a full picture of One Health, you have to look at the animal interface, the human interface, the environment interface, but you have to look at it in a cultural, political, social context, a bigger context. And so if we go back to that original definition of what One Health is, it talked about multiple disciplines. It didn't say veterinarians and ecologists and physicians, it said multiple disciplines. So we need to broaden and open up our disciplines in One Health to bring other viewpoints and people into it. Many DVMs will get an MPH. I want to see the DVM that gets a master's in anthropology or sociology or ethnobiology. These are some of the people that are going to go forward. So we're going to move to a different piece here with that as a background. We're going to take a look at future societal needs and opportunities because remember, we said we're here as veterinarians for society. So let's take a look at what this means. As we gaze in the future's hard, the prediction's very hard, especially if it's about the future. So, but there are some things that we know. There are future trends that are very predictable, and these will have very distinct impacts on your current career, on your lives, no matter where you are. One is globalization, that nobody exists in a vacuum, that we have globalization, and we have linkages of people, concept, cultures across the globe. These are two good books when you want to read something in your spare time, right? You have a lot of spare time, maybe over the holidays. But if you want to get a sense of, you know, why is the world so messed up the way it is right now? Well, it's because we did it, right? And we're handing it off to you. You guys, we're the master. You fix it. We're looking for you to fix it. But this gives an idea. Globalization is there. We have interlinked economies, multinational corporations, interconnected banking, and linked currencies. And I would say from my limited experience, in Canada, you probably have more of a sense of this than most of the people in the United States have. Because, you know, we're living in our big little United States island, and so we don't see that. When I got off in Toronto and drove down here, I saw all sorts of places that identified as being U.S. places. So, you know, we saw McDonald's and A&W root beer, and I saw all these places. I also saw Tim Hortons, which we don't have Tim Hortons, but you are linked globally more, I think, on a conscious level than what we are in the United States. We are also externally linked globally, but I don't think on a day-to-day level people recognize it and see it, whereas I think you do more here. We're seeing an economic power shift. There's a group of countries called the BRIC countries, Brazil, Russia, India, Indonesia, and China. And they are rising superpowers in turn, and these will have impacts. These will have impacts on your lives, one way or the other. Some may be positive, some may be negative. So, friends that live in Vancouver, you know, are finding that people will come from China and other areas and buying up all the property, and so it had a negative effect for them. But at the same time, they're coming in and spending and buying and taking their animals to veterinarians. So there's a trade-off there. Population growth, as we move from today and going forward about 30 years, 2 billion more people. As veterinarians, we have a responsibility to society. Who will feed those 2 billion people? You know, where will we prioritize our resources? If we look at the expenditures in North America on pet food, our expenditures on pet food in North America are greater than the gross national products of about 70 countries. You know, is that a good utilization of resources? Will we be challenged as veterinarians about using resources for pets? And so these are things that will affect us as we move forward. Movement to cities. Does anybody look at that picture? See any public health issues there? Yeah. You know, if we're seeing this sort of crowding, urbanization, where's the infrastructure to support this? If we're going to see zoonotic emerging diseases, this is certainly an area that they could come from. 27 megacities with 10 million people plus. That's a lot, and growing more rapidly. By 2025, and it's coming up quickly, within 10 years, 60% of the world will live in urban areas. As we move forward, you know, there are 311 cities greater than a million and 581 that have a population greater than Vermont. So huge concentration of people. There are public health issues. There are zoonotic disease issues. There are animal issues that get involved there. technology we're seeing and you're living through ages of all sorts of advanced technology. And I'm going to go back a slide here. Here's a gentleman on his cell phone on a camel. So what's happening in many areas in technology is you know, I'll say the United States, and I guess in Canada, you know, we went from, you know, people sending messages to each other to having a postal service, to having a telegraph, to having a telephone, and moving things very rapidly. Well, here, they just jumped past that. You know, 5 years ago, he could not have gotten a letter with any reliability from where he lived in a village to someplace 10 miles away. And now, with a cell phone, he can connect around the world. So technology for us has been an incremental addition, but for many people, it's just a quantum leap, a huge jump from going from nothing. I mean, they couldn't even send a letter to the point they can get on the phone and link with people around the world. Biotechnology, all of these things are going to affect you. And if we take a look, just this last week in the United States, the FDA approved genetically modified salmon. This is, you know, when I go to Europe and you talk about genetically modified, it's like, yeah, I see a no. I mean, it's like that. You can't even say the words. You cannot. It doesn't matter. I say, I have a genetically modified animal that will stop. If you eat one bite of it, it'll stop all heart disease and cure poverty. It's like, no, if it's GMO, we don't want that. So, you know, depending on that social, political, cultural aspect that you come from, you know, the genetically modified salmon may be great for people, and it may be horrific for others. But these are technology leaps that, as veterinarians, that we're involved in. When this came out, and I think I read it in New York Times, I've been watching this. This has been a 20-year process through the FDA. And so the FDA, a friend of mine, was quoted in here, Dr. Bernadette Dunham, who's the director of Center for Veterinary Medicine with the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, had talked about this, about it being safe. And one of the issues, one of the big issues, wasn't that it was safe to eat, but what impact does it have on the environment, or potential impact? And probably nothing held this back more than Jurassic Park. That, don't worry, those dinosaurs can never reproduce until they do. So, but these are things, as we were in school, we weren't looking at these technologies, we weren't looking at this stuff, and yet it's gonna have dramatic impact. In fact, my students say, well, Dr. V, it was easy for you to take histology because back then, like, the cell only had three parts. You know, it had had nucleus, cytoplasm, and cell wall. I mean, you know, how hard was that? You know, and probably only four or five elements, earth, fire, something. Anyway, but this technology is moving rapidly, and veterinarians and people working in public health are gonna be challenged to work with these things. Emerging diseases, these you probably get ad nauseum, right? No, you say, give us more. But emerging diseases are nothing new, but how rapidly they're emerging and what they're coming up, and big HIV, AIDS, and Ebola, and SARS, monkeypox, all of these are having huge economic, social, political impacts. I got teased a little bit this morning about, I think it was PED coming from Canada, or from the United States to Canada, and thanked us for that gift. And we also thank you for sending BSE down to us. but the impacts, you know, just a couple of stories. You know, the bacteria and the emerging diseases, they don't know borders. There's no passport for them to get there. They just come across. And the impacts are extraordinary. So, I don't know about the Canadian cost for PED, but for BSE, mad cow disease in the United States, the impact's approaching $30 billion, with a B, $30 billion. And that's for three cows that had BSE. That's huge impact. That's huge impact. Most of that comes from loss of trade to countries that would no longer take U.S. beef. Environmental trends, global warming, desertification, emergence of tropical diseases, environmental trends, resource diminishing, water, hydrocarbon fuels, arable land, pollution, let's go back one. In our time, my age time, we saw wars over hydrocarbon fuels for oil. We saw wars over oil. In your lifetime, you will see wars over water. You're going to see. Canada's got a lot of water, but it's hard to export it, right? I mean, I get a little political here. You know, if you drink this, that's your choice. But Fiji water, you know, do we really need to bottle water in Fiji and bring it to North America to drink? We don't have enough water here. I mean, if my grandmother had seen us pay $5, which someplace the other day it cost $5 to get a little bottle of water, my grandmother, living through the Depression with her kids, saw us pay for water when there's a water fountain there. But you have reusable bottles. Congratulations. Okay. But you will see wars and conflicts over water. Governance. We're seeing changes in governance like we have not seen previously. We have nation state versus non-state actors. Nation state's just a country, a sovereign country. Canada's a nation state. But we have non-state actors, ISIS, Al-Qaeda. Where's their capital? If you're going to fight them, how do you fight them? Where's their major ports? You can't go like World War II and bomb their ports and bomb their capital and make them give up. We're seeing emergence of different kinds of governance that are there. Again, Al-Qaeda and ISIS. We're seeing social, religious, and ethnic boundaries crossing current political boundaries. And so these are creating tensions. An example are the North Iraqi Kurds and the Turkish Kurds. These groups identify more with each other as Kurds than they do with their individual countries. And so in Turkey, they look at the Iraqi Kurds as being terrorists. From people in that area, they look at themselves as being liberators to be able to create that country, Kyrgyzstan, that would involve those people that have this the religious ethnic background that come together. Governance will be a big deal. I tried to find something similar from Canada, and I didn't, so I have to pull from the American Veterinary Medical Association, but they had a commission that looked, trying to look into the future, 2020 vision into 2020. And what they said is, for AVMA, changes are driven by globalization, technological advantages, and socioeconomic changes. Those very drivers that I just talked about. And so in the future, veterinarians are going to have to look at working in world context, internationally, global health, trade, food safety, security, and education. So you're all part of a bigger world that's involved here. So I want to give a couple of examples. This is from Canada. And the former Minister of Health, Ms. Ambrose, that talked about working through the global health security agenda. Are these words you've ever heard before? Global health security agenda? So I have a little head nod, maybe. It's okay. How about anybody else in faculty or whatever? Global health security agenda. I think, from my perspective, seeing this will be an extraordinary driver of both societal opportunities as well as resources. The U.S. and other countries have come together, including Canada, as part of the global health security agenda. And this is significant because it took a health issue and moved it out of the strictly health arena and put it in as a security issue. This is a national and world security issue. And so that subtle change is actually a big change from going from health to security. When you define health as a security issue, that brings in lots of other partners and activities. So if they take a look, moving forward to a safe and secure world, at, and let's look at the risks they identified. Emergence and spread of new microbes. See a vet issue here? Yeah. Because remember, up to 70% of the new emerging diseases are zoonotic or carried by animal vectors. So here, on the large scale things, place for veterinarians. And again, 70% vector-borne or zoonotic. The next one, globalization of trade and travel. We talked earlier about globalization and international. Well, we have a lot of linkages in terms of trade and travel. The rise of drug resistance is certainly big. And as I look at this, I can't speak for Canada's approach to drug resistance. I don't know. The U.S. is coming, from my perspective, a little late to the game and moving forward now rapidly, trying to catch up. And Europe is just like GMOs, antibiotic resistance, they're all over this. They're just crazed with it. And then the potential for accidental or intentional use of biothreat agents. So how many biothreat agents are zoonotic or of animal origin? Almost all of them. About the only two that are typically not considered of animal origin are smallpox and ricin. Those are the two that are not of animal origin. So of the big four, global health security risk, all of them have a big place for veterinarians. So if you're going to work in this arena, now I'm kind of switching over to global health, and here is in Tunisia at this time. Why did they put that head out there? That's a butcher shop. Why did they put the head out there? Who wants to make a stamp? Why did they put the head out there?
Fresh line.
Yeah, it's fresh. You know, if you have a fresh head, then that means that the food that you have in there is fresh. Now, they don't have much in there. They just have a couple of bones. But if you... You know, but if you see this, if you're buying food there, you know that this is a fresh slaughtered animal. So it's, and you know, for us, we would link that to health. They would too, but it's fresh, it's healthy. So if you see two carcasses out there and they're cutting on them, and one has flies on all over it, and the other one has no flies, which one do you want to eat? Right, you want flies? Why do you want flies? I'll have mine with flies. Yeah, I'll have flies with that. So why do you like flies? Okay, that's fine. Because the other one's probably...
Just kill fresh and you're going there and
yeah, and the other one is, they may have sprayed the other one with pesticides. So to keep the flies off, they'll spray them with pesticides. So. I'll go with the flies. If you have a choice, you know, go with that. So, you know, first thing working internationally is you have to have the right attitude. That when I first started working internationally, it was like I was going out to change the world. And now I found the world changed me. That I thought I had a lot to tell, and I found out that I had more to learn. And so attitude is critical. You have to have technical skills. If you're going to go. Language helps a lot. You have to be medically fit. You're working in places where you may not have access to healthcare. And so if you're not fit or something happens, it can be bad. And regulatory. And I always find this interesting because students, faculty, other veterinarians, they'll go in some country out, where are you doing? I'm going down to Guatemala and we're spaying and neutering dogs and cats in this village in Guatemala. Okay, that's good. Are you licensed to do that? Just because you have a degree from Canada, I have a degree from the U.S., I'm only licensed to practice in one state. Now, I can't give a shot. I can't give a rabies shot in another state. So a lot of people will overlook the sovereignty of a nation and go in and say, well, I'm a Canadian veterinarian. I'm a North American veterinarian. I can do everything. Well, you may be skilled. That doesn't mean you have the regulatory right to do that. I'd be very sensitive about that. You need to look at yourself, look at your values, look at the purpose of what you're looking to do, your resolve, because these are not easy environments to work in, very challenging. There'll be cultural challenges, there'll be time challenges. When I got picked up by the red car to come here is very efficient. They picked me up one time and drove me right here. In other countries that I've worked, wasn't quite that efficient. When I worked in the Middle East, we kind of teased about it, the IBM rule. And we think of IBM here in North America, you think of international business machines and computers and precision. IBM there were three Arabic words. The first one was inshallah, God willing. Will you be there at the airport to pick me up? Inshallah, God willing, which may mean it happens or not. The second one is bukra. Bukra, it means tomorrow. What bukra means is not now. It may happen tomorrow, or it could be not in your lifetime. Bukra has the same meaning as mañana, except without the intense sense of urgency. I mean, it may never happen. And Ma'alish was no big deal, no problem. Yeah. So when we try to put overlay our sense of time, place, and purpose over their cultural time, place, and purpose, it can be challenging. And finally, you want to be able to measure what results you have. So I'm going to just click up some categories, or go back one, that people can work in these arenas and try to click through very quickly. Intergovernmental organizations, I've worked with OIE and with FAO. I'm sorry, OIE, World Animal Health Organization, and Organisation Internationale Epizootique. Anyone from Quebec? Okay, yeah. So is that good enough? You give it a try? That's close enough. Okay. And FAO is the UN Food and Agriculture Organization. There are commercial opportunities out there, certainly technical, sales, marketing, management. There are nonprofits or non-governmental organizations such as Heifer Project International. They do have student programs. Sometimes people just decide they're going to do their own. This is a group called Project Vets. It was started by a veterinarian who used to work for me in private practice, and she enjoyed private practice, but she felt like she wanted to do more, so she just set up her own not-for-profit in order to get materials that were excess or unused in the United States over into other areas. Another friend, Haley Adams, set up the Silent Heroes Foundation, working a lot within Africa in the conservation area. They do have student programs available for this. And you'll have access to this, to these references. Veterinarians Without Borders in Canada is a very active organization. And if you look down here, it says, apply for a student internship program. So there are opportunities with Veterinarians Without Borders. I can't say this for sure. I do know in the US, there are externships available. Is this also true in Canada? But I bet through your contacts here, you could find a way, if you wanted to spend some time and look at public health, I'll bet that they'll find a way to make that happen. Christian Veterinary Mission. EcoHealth Alliance that we talked about before, and they do have a program for students that can apply for it. You can do things without physically being there. This is a disaster response. This is a group that I worked with, the Haiti, the medical and public health information sharing environment, that I did a lot of work with Haiti, but I never went to Haiti because I worked with groups through virtual working groups, providing maps, support, epidemiology advice on various things from afar. Here's some emerging fields that will be there, but probably it's 10 times larger than this. We just can't imagine what the new things would be. So how do you get there? You do your research, talk to people, set a career map, set goals, network. You have a wealth of experience that is here within the college, and use their network to help you find where you want it. But you have to know where you're going to go. If you have a GPS and you don't have a destination, how's it going to tell you? It'll tell you where you are, but it's not going to tell you how to get there. So at least have some idea of where you want to go. Experience and trade. People that are successful in these areas are brought in because they have built up a framework or an experiential portfolio that will allow them and be a trusted network to work in another area. So just because you want to do something doesn't mean you can. That in the vet profession, nobody here's a jerk, right? Yeah. Well, I ask my students, of course it's a full classroom, how many here are jerks? And about four or five hands went up. Yep. And it's like, well, I would like learn to be an unjerk, because we're an extraordinarily small profession, and if you're a jerk, and someone, you know, who wants to work with a jerk? So if you can't work well with others, if you can't collaborate, you'll be found out pretty soon, and you're not going to be invited to the parties anymore. Build a portfolio and just do it. Start at some level, and then just go forward. And then network. Use the resources here. So whatever it is that you'd want to do, or something you'd even want to explore, use your network to try to do that other thing. So this just shows some experience that I had in Panama, in Ecuador. This is also in Ecuador teaching. There's in Panama. Here's Belize, and that's in Bolivia. And it all comes down to Maria here, who brought her flock of sheep to us. And this is her flock. And it represents just the sheep, but more than that, what it represents for her is hope. Hope. Look at the clothes she's wearing. They're made out of wool. You know, from the sheep, she collects the dung and dries it and uses it to cook and heat with. It's a valuable commodity. She owns it. She can take it to the market and translate that into money. And it could give her the opportunity to go to school. So as we as veterinarians, I know we focus on animals, but our focus also, remember, is society's needs. And so what I can do for this animal translates into what benefit it is for Maria and others like her who are living in tough conditions, but it provides hope for a better future. And I'll stop with that and open it up for questions or discussions. Yes?
I wonder what, in your opinion, what the biggest challenges are to operationalizing One Health. And I'm thinking especially in terms of these large, I mean, there's different, you have NGOs, as you said, you have NGOs, private, corporations, individual governments, nation states that all have their own interests and mandates, and then this idea of One Health encompassing animal, human, environmental health. What do you see as the biggest challenges?
Sure. And I mean, that word is a word absolutely operationalizing that I used as I talked with One Health Commission, because they were asking about this exactly. Ultimately, I don't think One Health will be as effective and efficient as One Health until you merge the pieces and put them under a single funding source and a single source of authority. Because avian influenza did a lot to promote One Health, because it was an animal disease, it was a human disease, it had a huge economic impact. And people came together and worked together, some places better than others, but worked together with this. And then when the disease went away, the money went away, and everybody went back to their home stations. So One Health, I think, we're seeing this again now with new avian influenza in the United States. We're seeing with the antibiotic and antimicrobial resistance. And so it will become operationally effective when the people that are responsible are falling under, you know, one authority and one resourcing. Now, there'll still be pieces and parts that'll move forward, but I'm afraid it will leave with a crisis. So ultimately, I think that's gonna be it, where you don't have a Department of Agriculture and a Department of Health, you bring it together in a bigger piece.
So do you see that at different levels then, from national up to international?
I do. And if you look at, Yeah, there's some big things that come through. If you look at the global health agenda, if you look at the World Health Organization, and I didn't look at Canada's, but the U.S.'s plan, their national strategy and the international strategy on antimicrobial resistance, in there is, you know, there are like five lines of effort, and one of them is that this will take your One Health approach. So now you've taken it from just a concept, us talking about One Health, to national and international organizations, you know, saying you're going to approach this from a One Health aspect. So as soon as you do that, as soon as you put it into a base document, now it becomes real. There it's like, whoa, we have to do this. And funding follows that, all the pieces follow. I mean, it's a extraordinarily great question. I think veterinarians need to be comfortable and feel comfortable outside their vet arena and be able to work in a larger arena. And frankly, and I shouldn't pick on Gavin McGregor Skinner. He's a great guy, just fantastic. But I wish he just would have on national and international TV said, I'm a public health veterinarian working in the human arena. I saw this also with anthrax, where some of the key people working with anthrax in the United States when they had the anthrax letters were veterinarians. They're the ones that were being interviewed, but they identified themselves as being PhD scientists and not DVMs. It's a great question. Yes?
Following that, sometimes I think it's kind of hard to expect that after education and experience and a career that we're asking people to think in a One Health mindset, and it really should begin a lot sooner. So when you have gotten into school at the beginning of your veterinary training or your medical training or your public health training, that is encouraged, because it's harder to ask people to start to sort of jump on that bandwagon.
Sure.
And include it in reports and include it in the media and include it in your everyday language when you haven't had that thought process hasn't been happening. So for instance, I find that schools, veterinary schools that are in the same environment as medical schools or nursing, or they have that hub, they tend to have, well, there's more of that One Health momentum. Not to discredit, well, the OBC way. But I just wonder, in this environment where there isn't that, what would you recommend we do for students?
Another great question. Let me draw back. How many people know what ecology is? Have heard the word ecology, right? Everybody's heard the word ecology. In the dark ages, when I was in high school, I was doing some ecology research experiments. This is before Earth Day and whatever. And when I was doing these, I was developing models of ecological succession, and I had to tell people what ecology was, because nobody heard the word. So part of it is telling that story about what One Health is and reaching out to others. And I would go first for the low-hanging fruit. In the medical field, does a thoracic surgeon care much about One Health? No. I mean, the answer, they don't. But how about the public health doc or infectious disease doc? Yeah, they do. So I would reach out to those that we share common interests first and build that dialogue with them. And so I think this will move forward. And you know, for students that are coming to vet school, it's not like when I was 8 years old, I wanted to work in One Health. Well, no. When I was 8 years old, my bun died, and I knew I was going to devote my life to vet medicine. So we're going to have to attract people at a younger age with this idea of working in this other arena. And some will, some won't. But it may be a generation, it may be like ecology, it may be a generational thing to get us to that end. But it's a great question, Teresa. We need to stop in what, now, 5 minutes? Okay.
Related to that question, why did you take the job you're in now?
She knows the answer. So I was in Virginia, Maryland, and I was recruited to teach at a brand new vet school. And let me see, we'll get a piece of paper. I'll show you why I took a couple of reasons. One is the dean I know very well, and he's a very persuasive recruiter. And the other reason is this is what the curriculum looked like. Okay. Is a totally blank page. And they said, Gary, we want you to teach 5 courses through the first 3 years of vet school on One Health. 5 courses on One Health. Now, students, you may not appreciate this. Faculty, I know you know well. If I went to any other school, if I came to Guelph and said, Dean, can I teach 5 courses on One Health? I know. If I had come to you last year and said, Dean, can I teach 5? Do you think One Health's important, Dean? Yes. Could I teach 5 courses through the first 3 years on One Health? No. Because she would say, yes, you can. You just go convince faculty members to give up their time and their course time, because everybody's thing is most important, right? I mean, I pick on my, I don't have any neuroanatomists here, do I? Okay, well, I like to tease my net. If I just had more time on glial cells and an olivate nucleus, you know, then they'd really come out with a strong education. And so we teach, and we teach people, you know things on the molecular level. You know, right? You know the Krebs cycle. You know what cells look like. You know things on a real molecular level. Do you know how the world works? You know, I mean, we teach this not well, not every single school. We teach you histology and molecular level and all this stuff, and you know this, but you don't. We don't know collectively how to go into another culture and provide effective response to a major disease but I can tell you the Krebs cycle. If you want to know the Krebs cycle, glucose 6-phosphate goes in the glucose, yeah, anyway. So, part of it is to try to elevate this up and have students have a kind of a world view, no matter what level that they're going to work with. So that's the blank. Five semesters of courses to teach in One Health, blank sheet, and I could do whatever I wanted. That's pretty cool. Faculty understand that. You guys may later. Yeah. So could I have taught one full course that every student had to take in One Health? Well, probably not. No, and I'm not picking. Yeah, Virginia, Maryland, every vet school. I don't know. Did Woodrow Wilson, U.S. president, say it's harder to move a cemetery than to change a curriculum? I mean, it's tough. It's tough to change a curriculum. So I was very fortunate. Now, I'll be honest. Some of it is kind of disguised as One Health, like wolf in sheep's clothing, because my second semester, this next, I will teach the tools of One Health. Tools of One Health. That sounds pretty cool. Wouldn't you like to know about Tools of One Health? It's biostatistics and epidemiology. Yes, sir.
I think the danger of having, okay, now we're doing One Health, the students are going to come, and okay, now we're doing One Health. I think there another approach would be to integrate One Health throughout all the curriculum, so that when you're talking, the infectious disease person is bringing it in, and you're talking health management. So I'd say that's the risk of the way that you're going about it. Yeah.
And we're actually doing it both ways. But the easy way, I mean, understand, I agree totally. I mean, everybody's talking about clinical encounters, should be talking about the One Health. But that means I'd have to get all those faculty. So I can change them one at a time and kind of gradually bring them in. But absolutely, in a perfect world, it would be totally integrated through everything we do. But we don't have a perfect world. We have the world we have. Yes, sir?
You said exactly what I wanted to do. That's Elizabeth. You said it. Yeah. I mean, do you remember when I was a vet student back in the last century or something? A lot of the faculty actually were practitioners of public health. And people like Don Barnum and Mara Fish. And they just thought that way. They thought that way. They projected that approach to it. And I think once we get to that point, more into 5 courses, 20 courses, and more integrating the thinking in terms of the experience, the desires, the interests to a group of students and gather more community. That's an important thing.
And what you said to me, that's extraordinarily powerful. And I would come turn now to the students and challenge you is that, you know, it's not just a slogan, it's something, it's what you do. It's part of your job in your oath to society. And every day you're doing One Health. Every day you're doing public health. And honestly, I don't have time for that. You know, if you talk to a young father or a young mother about what you're doing for their dog is protecting their child, which parent doesn't want to protect their child? Now you're becoming part of the healthcare profession that protects their child from rabies, from scabies, from visceral larval migraines or ocular larval migraines. You could call it a marketing tool. It can be a marketing tool for you to do, but it elevates what you do and it elevates your worth and your value to society as you upgrade it every day. Yes, sir.
I see one weakness in your argument. I 100% with you. And this is a sort of bottom-up approach to addressing the issue. But the fact is, we're a tiny profession, and we can all come up with hundreds of examples of where the veterinary profession either followed rather than led, or wasn't visible, or wasn't even counted or consulted. And if you look through the general science media, like the Scientific American, for example, time and time again, everybody who's been involved will be described by their name and their qualifications and their affiliation. But it'll often say, and the veterinarians. So we as a profession have a huge job to do in terms of credibility, because unless we're able to mount an approach which is as forceful as, for example, the medical profession, because of their sheer size and funding, we'll still not be taken seriously. And although these guys have worked on wonderful things in small villages, perhaps in some third world country, if that's still a politically correct term, in terms of the overall impact, it will be minimal. So we as a profession, collectively, corporately, must be part of this change. Otherwise, it'll take us 40 years, and even then we'll still be playing behind the gate.
Sure. I agree 100%. And that's one of the reasons I go back to when you have an international movement, that global health security agenda. I mean, they've already outlined four lines of effort or concerns, all of which affect veterinarians. So that's the train that has the money, that has the political clout, it has the focus. So I wouldn't try to develop a new one. I'd hop on that train quick and bring our expertise, which is deep and broad, to the table and be part of something bigger. That's there, rather than try to develop our own standalone. So we better stop. I'll stay up here for a few minutes. If anybody wants a car or wants to give me money or anything, that's okay. Thank you very much for coming for your lunch hour. Really appreciate it.